नमो लोये सर्वत्रिकावर्ती अरिन्ताणम्। ओम नमो लोये सर्वत्रिकावर्ती सिद्धाणम्। ओम नमो लोये सर्वत्रिकावर्ती आर्याणम्। ओम नमो लोये सर्वत्रिकावर्ती उज्जैनम्। ओम नमो लोये सर्वत्रिकावर्ती सावनम्। ओंकारं बिंदु संयुक्तं नित्यं दायन्ति योगिनं कामदं मोक्षदं चैव ओंकाराय नमो नमः। नमः समयसाराय स्वानुभूत्या चकासते चित्स्वावाय भावाय सर्वभावान्तरचिदे अज्ञानतिमिरन्धानं ज्ञाना अञ्जनशलाकया चक्षुरुन्मीलितं येन तस्मै श्रीगुरुवे नमः। तीर्थंकरो जगतना जयवंतवर्तो ओंकारनाथ जिननो जयवंतवर्तो जिनना समो शरणसौ जयवंतवर्तो नेतीर्थचार जगमा जयवंतवर्तो नमो ए तीर्थनायक ने नमो ओंकारनाथ ने ओंकार संगरुते नमो ते श्रीकुंद कुंदने अहो उपकार जिनवरनो कुंदनो ध्वनि दीवनो जीन कुंद ध्वनि अहो ते गुरु खानो अहो ते भगवती मातनो ध्रुव अचल ने अनुपम गति पामेल सर्वेशी धन वंदी कहो सुत केवलि भाषित असमय प्रावृत अरे एक शुद्ध सदा अरूपी ज्ञान दर्शन मय खरे कहीं अन्य ते मारू जरी परमाणु मात्र नथी अरे जम नेत्र ते मज ज्ञान नथी कारक नथी वेद करे जाहि ज कर्मोदय नीरज राबंद ते मज मोचन। ओम नमः सिद्धेव्य ओम नमः सिद्धेव्य ओम श्री शुद्धात्माने नमः। जय जिनेन्द्र। Today is Wednesday, August 9, 2017, and we are going to continue our discussion on Samyasastanga 12.
Kirtankar?
Yes.
We're back in full swing now, right?
Yep.
Okay. Do you think we can, since we're back now full time, do you think we can accelerate a little bit? And I'll tell you why. Mm-hmm. Like what I've noticed is that it's great that we go in depth and we're taking it easy, but like there's a lot of overlap.
Mm-hmm.
And I feel like, you know, if we go a little faster, we can always revisit stuff, I would think. And I'm not suggesting we go crazy fast. It's just that, like, you know, a gatha every 4 months is kind of like, you know, that's kind of slow.
Yeah. I think, you know, basically, see, these are the first 12 and 16 stanzas are the heart of the Samayasara. And thereafter, everything is expansion of those things, you know. So, and again, I asked the same question to Hemanbhai also. In what he said, that because he keeps on repeating so many things, because he wants that point to be really, really, really sit very, very deep within our psyche. So that's what he's trying to, that's what Gurudev is trying to do there. And yes, there are lots of repetitions are coming and everything. And only the thing that he said that just keep on doing repetition and that will become your second nature for you, you know?
No, but Kirtanko, what I mean is, let me try to articulate what I mean. I'm not suggesting that we go faster to different concepts.
Mm-hmm.
I'll give you an example. In 3 years, we could have done the same 12 gathas like three times in the 3 years.
Mm-hmm.
And we would have had the same repetition and that's fine.
Yeah.
It's just that what I'm finding is, as we're going at the pace that we're going, like when I heard, when I listened, I was at all of Hemanbhai Gandhi's Swadhyays in New York.
Yeah.
And I heard him go, maybe not in the same detail that we did, but go in fairly significant detail on the first, I think he did the first nine gathas of Samyasa.
Yeah.
And you know, like some of the concepts, many of the concepts we had covered,
mm-hmm.
but I listened to him and I thought to myself, my God, it's been 2 years since we talked about Ekatva Nischay, you know?
Yeah.
And it's like, I feel like that's just way too long for us to have touched on such an important topic. And I think that's because of our pace. I feel like, you know, we could have done this a couple of times.
Yeah, we can do that. There's no problem with that. Because basically what it is that, you know, I follow what the Samyasa Siddhi tells us, you know? And if there is repetition, and right now today, there's lots of repetition will come, you know. And why? Because he decided that because 12th stanza is a really very wrongly understood by ignorant soul, you know. Because when it says that vyavahar nahi updesh for the aspirant soul, so then he says, no, the real meaning of that thing is not to give discourses for the conventional point of view, but he is aware, the aspirant soul is aware that while he is progressing from the Samyak Darshan to start with at the fourth spiritual stage, all the way to Keval Gnan on the 13th spiritual state, in between there are partial purity, partial impurity states coming, and partial purity keeps on increasing gradually. So he says that, that one is aware of that one. It doesn't mean that one has to give discourses in that one. Vavahar Desida word, last time we left it at the time. And so that point is, Gurudev has hit very, very hard again and again, because there is a confusion in the non-mumukshu samaj. And they'll say, look, in your samasar, it said that you have to give a conventional point of view discourses to the aspirant soul. That's a literal meaning, but then when Amrit Chandra Acharya writes the critics on that, he takes a different meaning out of it. So those are the things that we... So whenever those points are coming, we will try to just go a little bit faster for those things when we know there's a repeat point. Because yes, I was looking at the 38th slide today and it says Vavahar Desida, and on 58th slide, the same thing comes up because Gurudev started repeating those things. So we will just make sure that we will pass through, because as long as we understand that part, then we'll pass through, okay?
Okay.
No problem. All right. So let me bring the share screen. Okay. Okay. So last time we were having the word Vavahar Desida. That was a word that means, Vavahar means a conventional point of view. Desida, literal meaning is to give the discourses. So this word is vachak. Vachak means, if it means discourses on conventional point of view, literal meaning of the word, literal meaning. But the intended meaning is vacha is different. For example, father is asking a child that give me water. He said, After 5 minutes, father says, give me water. He says, Third time, daddy is increasing his tone and says, don't you listen that I'm asking you to give me water? He says, yeah, you told me three times that give me water. And now third time, you're raising your voice. Now, did he listen to it or he did not listen to it? Well, yeah, he did listen to it. He listened three times, but he did not act on it. So that vacha, the vachak means bring the water. He listened to that, but he did not act. So vachya was different, means to go to the kitchen, bring the glass of water and give it to daddy. That was the intended meaning. So if we don't do that, then it becomes kind of a confusing thing. So vavahar desida means what? It means to know partial purity and partial impurity state. The soul in the fourth spiritual development state, he just experiences soul, eternal soul substance. When he experiences the eternal soul substance, then in his mode, the two types of modes are seen. One part of the mode has a partial purity present. Other part of the mode has partial impurity present. So both are still present. And the aspirant soul is aware of this situation. He knows that in my mode there is a partial purity and there is partial impurity. He is aware of it. And that's what Kalvachya means. It means this is conventional point of view. When he is aware of a partial purity and partial impurity state, That means it's a conventional point of view, because now we are talking modal point of view. Whenever we talk modal point of view, that is called conventional point of view. Not only modal point of view, but in the mode also we see partial purity and partial impurity we are experiencing. And that's why it is called conventional point of view. Whenever the conventional point of view, absolute point of view, we need to define over here, absolute point of view means to have faith on the eternal soul substance. And conventional point of view means to know what's happening in the mode. Modal point of view is conventional point of view. And absolute point of view is eternal soul substance. Now, if to put my attention to eternal soul substance and modal point of view is called conventional point of view, do I care for conventional point of view? And Acharya Bhagavan says, yes. Why yes? Because in conventional point of view, the purity is occurring. Mode is the one which brings the attention to the eternal soul substance. Until now, for time infinite, this soul has not looked at the eternal soul substance. Now, in the mode, knowing what's a reality, the soul, or the person, the living being, brings attention to the eternal soul substance. Where is this attention occurring? In the mode. So modal point of view is also present. But when we talk about absolute point of view, the modal point of view is made secondary, and its existence is known but made secondary. Lots of people will just say, conventional point of view is abhutar, conventional point of view is wrong, conventional point of view is not to be considered. If that is the case, then remember our seven stanza. What did seven stanza say? The charitra darshan gnan pran nahi kate nahi. Well, let me read that line. Charitra darshan gnan pran.
It's the abheda of the gun, I believe.
Yeah. So charitra darshan gnan pran vyavahar kathane gnani ne charitra nahi darshan nahi me gnan gnayak shuddh che. Means, you know, the division, the attributes division, that I have the knowledge mode, I have the knowledge attribute, I have a faith attribute, I have a conduct. So if I'm looking at those divisional way, then also it's called conventional point of view. And if I get stuck on that one, then I will not get enlightenment. I will not get experiencing the soul. So conventional point of view doesn't mean that, oh, this is conventional point of view, it's wrong. This conventional point of view is wrong. No, we have to understand both, and we have to keep the balance of both. Because actions are occurring in the mode. Yes, I would like to have the eternal soul substance attention, but that attention is drawn in the mode. So mode's existence is also to be acknowledged. One cannot say that, you people from Songhad and Kanji Swami, you always don't believe in a convention point of view. Buddha says, wait, when did we say that? Convention point of view is to be respected as much as the absolute point of view. But when we compare both, then convention point of view becomes secondary, and that's why it's been negated. That's what it means. Motive for this test is for knowing purpose. Now, this soul has a partial purity and partial impurity. He has an attention focus on the eternal soul substance. And now in the mode, he has a partial purity generated. So he is aware of the partial purity state. He is aware of the partial impurity state. And this state is for this particular aspirant soul, is for knowing purpose only. He doesn't entirely depend on it. It's for knowing purpose. That yes, I'm on fourth spiritual development state, I'm on fifth spiritual development state, I'm on sixth and seventh. And at that time, he's aware of his impurities present within him. Seventh Gunsthana and sixth Gunsthana, the monk is in a absolute meditation phase. still he is aware of his weaknesses. He is aware of those things. It is for knowing purpose for him. Samyak Darshan Jeev on a fourth spiritual state, he also has rag and dvesh present. He is aware of it. He doesn't adore that one. He doesn't say that, okay, you know, you're mithya drashti, so you when you have the rag and dvesh, it gives a bondage of karma. And me, I'm in the fourth spiritual state, maybe fifth, maybe sixth, that I don't have rag and dvesh. No, you have a rag and dvesh according to the stage, but you don't depend on it. It's for knowing, it's for knowing purpose. It's not for adoring purpose. How do we describe a monk? He has 28 primary virtues. We know that monk has 28 primary virtues. And so we talk, we give the description of a monk through his external appearances. But that is not his true state. His true state is he is getting in intense engrossment in his eternal soul substance. That is his real nature. Now we are seeing that outside 28 primary virtues we are seeing, and that's why we just said that, okay, that's why this is monk. That's not true. Sure, 28 primary virtues are there, but behind that particular monk has an extreme intense experiencing of the soul, and that's why he's called Bhavlingi Sant. Means inclinations are to the eternal soul substance. He is engrossed in that one. One does not honor this state. Means when he is aware of it, fourth spiritual state, fifth spiritual state, sixth spiritual state, he is aware of its state. He doesn't say that I'm honoring that state. He is actually feeling that this is pain to him. His weakness is there. Because of his weaknesses, he has this influence of attachment and aversion. And that's what is happening. So he doesn't honor that state. He's simply aware of it. And he would like to remove those things. His intentions are to remove those things. He doesn't say that, oh yeah, you know, I'm 28 primary virtues, so I'm going to honor that state. Honoring occurs in the internal experiencing of the soul. Honoring occurs in the fourth spiritual state when he is experiencing soul. Honoring occurs when he is in the fifth spiritual state and experiencing his soul. That is called honoring. Associated rag and dvesh are not to be honored. That is his weakness. He is aware of it. He knows that that's his instability, because that does not allow him to stay in the eternal soul substance. So he makes all his attempts to remove those impurities. Now, when one takes refuge in the eternal true nature of self, then he obtains right faith. We are aware of it. He has right faith, right knowledge, and right conduct naturally. But in this state, there is presence of partial purity, partial impurity, okay? At 13th spiritual development state, he obtains complete purity. Partial impurities are totally gone. He's at 13th spiritual state and he has complete purity. In this state, from 4th to 12th spiritual development state, he has presence of milder form of rag, increase of attachment. Milder forms are present. He is aware of it. And he makes all his effort to remove those kind of things. This partial impurity state is known as conventional point of view. So whenever there is a conventional point of view, there is also associated absolute point of view. And remember, the true form of conventional point starts when one experiences his soul at a fourth spiritual development state. And then this partial point of view comes into existence. So now we have done an exhaustive swadhyaya on 11 stanzas and everything, and we went through a lot. Yes, we did a lot, and we did the learning process so that when we get the experiencing of the soul at a fourth spiritual development state, then absolute point of view and conventional point of view will coexist. Right now, we don't have it because we are in the mithyatva gunsthana. On the same token, on 13 spiritual development state, when a person is become omniscient knowledge, does he have partial point of view or not? No. Why? Because he has obtained complete knowledge. His complete knowledge. The partial point of view occurs only in the Sutta Gnan, means scriptural knowledge only. So, in the first spiritual development state, because I don't have experiencing of the soul, so there is no partial point of view. In the 13th spiritual state, there is an omniscience knowledge is there, complete and knowledge encompassing the everything of the universe is there, and so there is no partiality there, because there is no Sutta Gnan there. So for omniscient Lord, there is no partial point of view. For first Gunsthanat, Mithyatva, there is no partial point of view because there is no experiencing of the soul. So only experiencing of the soul starts absolute point of view and conventional point of view, starting at fourth, goes all the way to 12th spiritual development state. He knows this state. He does not honor this state. He is aware of his impurity state. He is aware of it. He knows it's his weakness. He wants to take it out of it. He works extremely hard at it. And sometimes it doesn't happen. But the efforts are not in vain. For example, Kunkun Swami was in 6th and 7th spiritual development state. And he was not able to progress further because somewhere along the line, his efforts were not that intense. Now, we are talking about intense effort. The Muniraj was absolutely in his eternal soul substance he was engrossed within. But he did not progress from 7 to the 8, 9, 10, 12. So now what happened? When he left this physical body, his soul ended up going to heaven. What happens in heaven? He is a Kshayik Samyak Darshan, and now he's in heaven. What happens there? His spiritual development state drops from 6 to 4. Now, will he be happy about it?
Miserable.
When you are in the 6th and 7th state, and a little bit extra push and everything, and you could have become omniscient Lord, now from 6th state, 6th to 7th state, you fall down to 4th spiritual development state. Was he going to be happy about it?
He'll have upratha kani misery.
Yeah, he has a misery going on, and he says, why me? Why should I not do the increased effort when I was a human being? But that doesn't mean that his efforts are in vain. Next life, he'll become the human being, and thereafter, he'll going to be omniscient Lord thereafter. So every effort you do, the right way or wrong way, there is a fruition of that effort. For example, let's say I did a dvesh to somebody. I become angry at somebody. What happens? I get a karma bondage occurs, and those karma bondage stays with me, and they remain in the dormancy state, and then they, in the future they come in the fruition. And at that time I get a miserable state. That is long, long gone thing. Actually, when I'm doing dvesh or rag, either of the one, at that particular moment, I get the fruition of that state and I get perplexity state. Akuta. Akuta thavi rag dvesh karyu, any immediate fall che akuta. Means I get perplexity right now when I'm doing rag and dvesh. And thereafter, karma gets bonded, and then they will come in fruition, and they'll make my life whatever. That's in the future. The person, he's a criminal. His criminality is been proven in the court, and the judge says, you'll be hanged to death. So he got the punishment at that time. Now the appeal and counter-appeal and all those things go, and it may last for 1 year, 2 years, whatever, and ultimately he gets up hanging to death. So the judge, when he gives the judgment, at that time he did get the result. When I have rag and dvesh, perplexity is my result. My peace gets disturbed. You know, in a rag thing, in an increase of attachment state, how come there's perplexity? Because we don't see it. Our intellect is so blunted that we are not able to feel that perplexity. I'm happy right now. I'd gone to the restaurant. Whatever I want to eat, I'm eating it. What's the problem? Well, that is the perplexity there. And one has to go in detail to understand the perplexity. But rag and dvesh gives perplexity right there and there. So here comes, when there is enlightenment occurring by taking refuge in the eternal source substance, then right faith, right knowledge, conduct got manifested. Is still a partial impurity present. That is milder form of inclination of attachment there. To know this milder form of impurity is known as conventional point of view. So Gurudev kept on hitting this point again and again. What is conventional point of view for the aspirant soul? And conventional point of view will be seen only in the aspirant soul, not in the Mithyatva, not in the omniscient Lord, only from the 4 to 12. So when he knows the impurity, that's a conventional point of view. He knows this state. It means conventional point of view is knowing purpose only. Jane lo pravajan vanche.
Here, Uncle.
Yeah.
When you defined, I think a couple of gathas ago, when you had defined Vyavarne, you had said that all these nays live within Shruti Gnan. Now, here we're saying that Vyavarne doesn't begin until Gunstan 4. But Shruti Gnan starts with Gunstan 1, right? Wait, 0. It starts. Shruti Gnan lives with Ekindriya Ji, right?
No, but you know, that is called Kusrut Gnan. Susrut and Kusrut. Kusrut means wrong form of a scriptural knowledge. And Susrut means right form of scriptural knowledge. Yes, I have in our state, I have a Srut Gnan, but that Srut Gnan tells me this is the pen and I love it. Means right away I put my ownership on it. And that's why it's called Kusrut. But the aspirant soul, say, he will say, this is a pen. He doesn't bring his ownership on this pen. So again, spoken words are limitations. So even the Nani Purush also will say, yeah, this is a pen and I love it. But internally, he knows that that's his weakness when he says, I love it.
Does that mean that Vyavarne only, sorry, does that mean that all nays exist only in Samyak Shruti Gnan?
Yes.
And it does, and no nays exist in Mithya Shruti Gnan, Kur Shruti
Gnan? No, because for Vyavarnai to be called Vyavarnai, you have to compare with somebody with whom you will compare. With the absolute point of view. Okay. When they're experiencing is there, that's an eternal soul substance experience. That's a Nishchay Nai. That means now I have my weaknesses. That's called Vyavarnai.
When people colloquially, you know, just as a matter of speech, say that this is Vyavarne, then it's not, unless the person saying that is fourth Gunstan. Correct?
Well, you know, I mean, as I said, that because of the language limitation, we also will use the word that this is Vyavarne, I should not have so much rag and dvesh and everything, but it is not true form. It's a fallacy of Vyavarne. I think you are reading that the seventh chapter. There's a fallacy of absolute point of view, fallacy of our convention point of view, fallacy of absolute and convention point of view, both. The three chapters in the seventh chapter, you know, sub-chapters.
Yes, that's true.
So there it says that the absolute point of view is there, then and then accompanying things which is in the mode can be labeled as a Vyavarne. So why do I do all this thing? Same thing happens in Krambat Paryaya also. Krambat Paryaya, the real thing starts when you have the understanding, I mean, experiencing of the soul. Thereafter, Krambat Paryaya in the real form is there. So what happens then now to me? I understand Trumbak Pariyai. I understand that, you know, I don't have to have my ownership on the alien objects of the world. I cannot change other objects. I cannot even change my own object. That will bring me towards the experiencing phase of the soul, because now I studied those things. I studied and it makes sense to me. Actually, you know, one of my school friend, he wrote the email to me, and he is very critical about religion and says religion is kind of a humbug thing and everything. Well, I said, hey, this is your viewpoint, and if you believe that way, it's okay. I'm not there to change your viewpoint. So I understand Krambat Pariyai. I understand Vyavarna Nishchayani, but just by understanding, am I trying to put into my action also? So today something happened and it was a situation making me giving rag or giving me dvesh. Am I aware of it to make it sure that I don't get involved too much? I can do that, and that is called kashaya nimandata. Means toxic emotions are getting suppressed. Initially, when a person gets a samyak darshan, he will have a suppression of the toxic emotions. That is the real experiencing of the soul. But if my toxic emotions become milder, but they don't get suppressed, milder only, tomorrow they'll become major. So in Mithyatva Bhutstana, I may have minor to major toxic emotion phases. But when one has really, really worked hard and tried to understand the nature of the reality and everything, and try to go in that direction, so one day I will experience my true nature of the soul, because Gurudev has explained to me all these things. I understand that part. And now actually only the thing I have to put into the action. The kid need to put the action that bring the water to the daddy. That sort of thing is missing. We all know all these things, but we don't do the action. Our action is not reflected in our understanding. So that's why sometimes I can give lecture and I can talk about everything, but when the problem comes, then I just freak out. For example, there was one story that one student was there, and he was coming regularly for the swadhyay and everything. And one time, every day he was coming. One time he did not come for 2 weeks. I mean, 10 days, he didn't come. And after 11 days when he came, the guru became very mad and says, what happened to you? You are a great kid. You are a disciple of a right guru and everything. What happened? So the kid says, Guruji, my mother died. So what? Everybody who is born, they are going to die and everything. So you keep on doing, you keep on repenting on those things. You are not good and everything. So he gave a big lecture. After about a month or two, suddenly the teacher became absent. And the student said, after several days, the teacher didn't come. So student said, Guruji, what happened? So Guruji said, my goat died. So this pupil says, wait a second, when my mother died, you gave a big lecture and a goat died and you are in the sorrow state for so long? The guru said, the mother was yours, goat was mine. So what I mean to say in this one, that you can speak. See, we got to separate two things in our mind. Jnano kshayopsham. I have the capacity to read all the things. I have capacity to understand all these things. But that doesn't mean anything. Only when I act on it and become experiencing the soul, then and there, that knowledge becomes important. And that knowledge may not be much. The lion, the Mahavishnu's previous life was a lion's life. And he had two monks passing through the sky and said, wait a second, this is a future Mahavir. What is he doing right now? Killing the deer and eating meat and everything? So they descend and they give a discourses to the lion. One student and two teachers. And that lion realized, what did he realize? Soul and body are separate. He didn't know six substances. He didn't know nine are reals and everything. He didn't know samasa and everything. He just knew my body, me as a body, and me as a soul are two separate things. Once Hiracle, he realized that, then he got a samyak darshan.
Hiracle, there's a wonderful thing. This year at Jhana, I remember that Pandit Sanjeev Gora said, and this was in response to a question about sambhagyan. Mm-hmm. And he said, you know, you can, in other words, you know, the difference between non-avaran and you know, suppression of darshanmo and chaitramo.
Yeah.
And he said that, you know, knowing all these shastras and knowing all these slokas and knowing the bhavat and the upotkat, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera, you know, that really is non-avaran. You might have a jeev that is samyak drashti that may not have such tremendous kshayaksham, yes, of non-avaran. Mm-hmm. And that jeev might call niyamsar tatwata, and tatwata samesar, and samesar prachansar. He won't know. Mm-hmm. But he knows that he's not any of that. He knows what he is, and that's all you need to know.
8th and 9th stanza, when we went through it, it says that the Sutta Kevali is what? One who has digested 12 original canons, bar Anganu Janagnanche, he is the Samyak Darshi Jeev. Or, other way of looking at it, one who has experiencing of the soul, he already has known the 12 agams. Why? Because the nutshell of 12 agams is what? To experience yourself. And so, if you take that shortcut, then you know all the 12 ang for sure. Now, 12 ang means what? I mean, we have to be a little bit aware of it. First thing is acharang, which is 18,000 chapters are there, and one chapter has 5.1 million slokas. That's an acharang. Then second one is a double that side, and third one is higher than that, and fourth. So all the 12 ang, it's a huge, 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 huge sutagna.
But no. Hemant Bhai also said that you know, you'll have a Tiryans Jeev who's in the fifth Gunsthanak who won't be able to recite any of this, but at least that Jeev knows what he's not. He knows the difference between himself and something else.
Because he's Sangni Panchendriya Jeev, right?
Right.
Sangni, he has a mind and all the senses, and now he has brought his mind toward the eternal soul substance, and he experienced. That's all it is. Now, talking other way around, the abhavi jeev. Abhavi jeev means the one who will never, never, ever, ever, ever get liberated.
Right, 11 angs and 9 purvas.
Now, what did he learn less than that? Tell me. 11 ang and 9 purva, only 5 more purva, and he'll be getting the samyak darshan. But this is abhavi jeev. What did he do at that time? Well, if his capacity to learn all these things, remaining 5 purva is not a big deal for him to learn. But when he comes to the 10th purva, then he has a lots and lots of special capacities are generated within him. And when he has those capacities get generated, like going, walking over the water, walking on the sky, and all kind of things, that 63 ruddhis are there. And he can get those things. Once he gets that, he gets involved with that. He loses his attention, and that's why he falls down. Hmm. So, two-part. Kshayopsham means the knowledge that I have it right now, and my faith, they go hand in hand. Think about it. 5 years back, 10 years back, when you guys were in the college and everything, where were you at the time? And today, where are you right now? Knowing 3 years that we are just week in and week out, we are just talking about this thing. So your faith is more towards eternal soul substance. So two parts we do. If I don't understand all these things, don't worry, but faith has to be there. And for the faith to come, you need to have knowledge to understand the knowledge. And so both the things go side by hand in hand. So those are the things that we have to keep in mind. Okay. Now, once belief that with conventional state, he will obtain absolute state is a wrong belief. I have rag and dvesh. I have a rag and dvesh within me. And it is in my mortal state. And I say, okay, with the help of this rag and dvesh, I will obtain absolute point of view. It's a wrong belief. Remember, the word belief is very important. It doesn't say that you should not do the activities. Like you have rag and dvesh, your dvesh is becoming less and less and less. If you understand this philosophy, then your intensity of inclination of aversion is blunted. But we still have rag. I would like to have that Tesla. I would like to have that Mercedes. I would like to have good food. I would like to have a good house. Those kind of rag, we still have it. And by having those things, I'll be able to obtain absolute point of view. That is wrong. Your rag can wax and wane. It can go intensity up and down. That doesn't do anything to the experiencing the soul. It needs to be suppressed to start with. And when we talk about karnani yoga, there is a specific reason given how a person first obtains samyak darshan. Very first time in this existence, a soul is able to get the samyak darshan. How? Because he is able to suppress his rag and dvesh for the time being for at least 48 minutes or less. When we say 48 minutes or less, means it could be fraction of second also. But if I was able to suppress my rag and dvesh, then there is no darshan monya karma. That means ke now I'm experiencing myself. And that's a first state. The first state will be suppression of the karma or suppression of my toxic emotions. So if I say I'm going to have convention point of view and then I'll also get the absolute point of view, that's a wrong belief. Belief is very important. I have knowledge. What is right knowledge? I know how to get the samyak darshan. Now I have to go towards the right belief state. But if I say, no, this is good for me and everything, and by that one, I'm going to get something that's a wrong belief. Another one, auspicious activity, one will end up with experiencing the eternal trueness of the self is a wrong belief. I'm doing Shubhav, and that will lead me to get the experiencing the soul. That is a wrong belief. That doesn't mean you should not do those things. Yes, you just have to do all those activity. Auspicious activity you perform, so that way you are staying away from the inauspicious activity. But at that time, I should be aware of it, that this auspicious activity alone will not let me get the true experiencing of the self. And that is the wrong belief, that auspicious activity will end up with experiencing the eternal trueness of the self. Yes, auspicious activities will come on the process when I'm on the process to get the experience of the soul. But that needs to be made secondary. When I'm a farmer and I'm growing the grains and now the grains are ready in the springtime, what do I see? Do I see all the cornfield, huge cornfield, or along with the cornfield, the hay also gets generated? Do I look at the hay or do I look at the cornfield? So, as auspicious activity are like a hay growing along with the cornfield. So you have to go give that importance in that pattern only. It doesn't say you should not do it. Remember, most of the people, they take wrong meaning over here, and they say, oh, so auspicious activity is not to be done because it's a wrong thing. So if you don't want to do auspicious thing, what will you do? Inauspicious thing? Three things are important. Three things you can soul can do to stay in the eternal innate state with the auspicious activity or inauspicious activity. I don't have innate state experiencing, so I have only two things left, auspicious inauspicious. I don't want to do auspicious because they are the hindrance for getting the experiencing of the soul. Then will I do inauspicious activity? Is Acharya Bhagavan telling you that you do inauspicious things? No. To Gurudev Kanji Swami, some people went and says, you know, Gurudev, you're making it too complicated, and make it simple and let us know what it is. So Gurudev said, okay, I can give you in two sentences. Swamagvas parthikas etlukartabhas. Stay within, get out of the alien objects, that's all you're doing. Now the guy said, yeah, but how do I get out of the in my inclination from the alien object? Then you have to come here to listen to me. That's what he said. So here, auspicious activity, with one will end up with experiencing that eternal soul that is wrong belief. Only when one leaves this conventional state, both of the above bullets are conventional state, then he obtains absolute state. In auspicious state, first disappears. Then auspicious state comes, and this leads to ultimate to pure state. This belief is a wrong belief. Let me take my all the inauspicious thing away. I'll do all this tapascharya and I'll do all this fasting and everything. So let me do that and let me get out of the inauspicious state. Then I'll be in the auspicious state and that will lead me to the ultimate pure state. That's a wrong belief. What is belief? It doesn't say you don't do it, but that belief is a wrong thing. And that belief has to be very strong. So if a parishan is coming next week and everything, so with our capacity, yeah, we will do whatever way we can do it. Yeah, I mean, ekasan or upvas or whatever. That is to be done. But that is not the end part of it. Because I'm not eating, that means food-related timings are taken away and I have a lot more time to do swadhyay. So I'll do swadhyay. I'll try to go within myself. And who knows, in this holy days, I'll experience my true self. And so that can happen. This tantra does not take into account of wrong faith as well as omniscient state. We already talked about it. It just talks, this tantra only talks about the fourth spiritual development state or the 12th spiritual development state, because they have the absolute point of view and convention point of view. In the wrong faith, there is no absolute point of view, so there is no conventional point of view. In omniscient state, there's a complete knowledge. There is no sutagnan. Sutagnan disappears and omniscient knowledge occurs. And omniscient knowledge knows everything about the self and everything about the universe. And so there is no sutagnan. So there is no sutagnan. The nai is a part of the sutagnan. And when there is no sutagnan, then there is no nai. Now you may say, what happened to sutagnan at the time? Well, there is a day today and there is a cloudy day. You can still see the sunlight filtering through the clouds. But now the clouds disappear completely and the sun is shining. There is no partiality. There is a complete shining of the light that I can see on the earth, I can experience on the earth. So that's an omniscient state. So when omniscient state occurs, then matignan, sutagnan, avdignan, manaparignan, they get disappear. Means they are part of the omniscience knowledge. Means they are complete omniscience knowledge. Keval means only knowledge. There is no partial point of view, no nothing. So that's what it says. It deals with the aspirant soul state from fourth spiritual development state onwards. 4 to 12, but mainly we deal with the 4 to 6, 4, 5th and 6th spiritual development state. That will be aspirant soul state. Because 7th spiritual state, person is in experiencing phase. 8th, 9th, 10th and 12th, he is also in the experiencing phase. So those are experiencing phase. We don't consider them for this topic right now. So aspirant state is...
Why? Yeah.
Because Shuddha Gnan in the 7th state, 8, 9, 10 and 12, Shuddha Gnan has devoted complete attention to the eternal soul substance. It is experiencing is occurring because of Shuddha Gnan at that time. So Shuddha Gnan is important. Shuddha Gnan is important because it is indirectly, it is experiencing of the soul. Like Keval Gnan is a direct experiencing of the soul. Soul itself has an omniscience knowledge. There is no need for any senses and everything.
No, but you had said that this does not apply to Gunsthan 7, 8, 9, and 10. Why?
Because at the 7th spiritual state, 8th, 9th, 10th, and 12th, the soul, the living being is engrossed in the eternal soul nature. He's totally engrossed, so he has no rag or dvesh, nothing left.
Oh, okay.
Now.
Oh, there is, though.
Yes, I know you are going to ask that question. Yeah, there is a rag and dvesh because up to 10th Gunsthanak, end of 10th Gunsthanak, there are Sanjvaran Kashai is there, right? When soul is experiencing eternal soul thing, then it is experiencing in total. Now there is a presence of a Sanjvaran Kashai present. Sanjvaran Krodhman Mayalob are present, but they are going at the below the intellect level that this soul cannot pick them up. So then he is mainly experiencing the soul only, and there is a below the radar. When those things are happening, he's not able to pick it up, and so it is as good as not having there.
So then Vyarane pretty much refers to 4 to 7. 4 to 6, rather.
4 to 6, basically. Yes, you are right. You are right. But you have to understand both the things, that we have why up to 12th also, and why not up to 12th also. So those are the things we have to have clarity in our mind. For example, Bharat Maharaja, he's in a 4th spiritual development state, and he has a 16,000 wives. Now, does he live with them? Yes. So, Does he have the karma bondage because of that? Yes. But while he is enjoying those women, he also says, this is not my real nature. This is not my true state. My true state is my eternal soul substance. This is my weakness that I'm getting involved with this running of the state and having the family and everything. So he's aware of it, and he's not enjoying in quote-unquote enjoying about it. No. He's doing it because he has that weakness. He has that instability of his self not to get engrossed in the eternal soul substance. That's why that happens. So he also, Bharat Maharaja also has apratyakhan, pratyakhan, and sanjvan kashar, and he has a bondage of those things, of course.
Okay.
Aspirant soul is partial purity, partial impurity state. This partial impurity state is known as bonded state. Bonded state is called conventional state. Free state is called absolute state. There is a karma bondage occurring. How did karma came in the picture? Because I had the rag and dvesh. When I'm in the impure state, then I had the rag and dvesh. And with that amount of rag and dvesh, according to my gunsthanak level, I will acquire those kind of karma to come to me, but they'll be very minimal in nature. Here it will be okay to just check something in the Karnaniyo. For example, we are in the first Gunsthana. And we have bonded karma since time infinite.
Kirtankal, I'm so sorry to interrupt for a second. I am in the hospital and I need to leave, but can I ask you to forward me this video of this?
No problem.
Jai Janendra.
Thank you. Bye. Jai Jan. So, where we were? What was the thing I was talking about?
You were talking about the aspirant soul.
What's that?
You're talking about the aspirant soul.
Oh, aspirant soul. Okay, all right. Yes. We are in the first Gunsthana, right? So now I'm bonding karma right now. Now, when I'm bonding karma, let's presume example, we are taking example, that I'm bonding a karma today right now, which will come in the fruition 100 days from now. Tomorrow I'm binding the karma, which will come in the fruition at 99 day. Day after tomorrow, I'm the bonding karma, it will become in the fruition at 98 day, so on and so forth. So on 100th day, there's so many karmas accumulated from day 1 to day 99, and they come in a fruition. They come in a fruition. And they give me the results of the fruition, whatever it is. So one unit of karma comes in fruition, and once they come, then they get dissipated. One samay, there's fruition, the next samay, they get dissipated. Now, so each and every time when I have a fruition of karma and I don't pay much attention to it, so I was able to dissipate one unit of karma. Right? Now, yeah. On a Samyakdarshi Jeev, Samyakdarshi Jeev, it's not only one unit of karma comes in fruition. 100 and infinite number of karma come in fruition at the same time. And they last for one samay and then they dissipate.
Yeah, this is the difference between akam and sakam nidra, right?
Yes, you are very good to pick up those things. What is sakam and akam nidra? Sakam means I have put my effort because I experienced my soul. So when I experience my soul, karma fruition occurs, and at that fourth Gunsthana, when karma fruition, tons and tons of karma fruition occurs, I remain in equanimity, so those karma get dissipated. So now, is it okay for me in the Mithyatva Gunsthana to remove only one unit of karma, and in the Samyak Darshan, I can remove tons and tons and millions of karma I can remove. So that's why it becomes imperative for us to be in the, to go into the state in which I can experience my soul. That's called Samyak Darshan. That way, my karma can get they hasten so much for dissipating. He knows this state. He's aware of this state. It is knowing purpose, janela pravajan vanche. This word will keep on coming again and again because this is Samyak Darshi Jeev. He knows that he has a partial purity, partial impurity. He knows about it, simply knowing. He's not adoring that state. Now, we are starting commentary by Amritchandra Acharya Dev here. What he said, impure gold is getting pure. During this process of purification, gold is passing through the stages. Now, Gurudev is using the simile, which is difficult for you to understand. He says, sol vallu sono. Sol vallu means one purity, second purity, third stage, fourth stage, and up to 16th stage. Sol ana, 16th ana was becoming 1 rupee at that time. So when you say sol vallu means 16 times, that means complete purity. So impure gold is passing through those purification state. When purification process is completed, then the gold is said to be 100% pure. Similarly, when the aspirant being passing through the purification process, then ultimately achieves 100% purity state. He has started and he is going to achieve. Kripaladev used to say, listen, you experience a soul, you experience a self. Once you experience, and if you don't get liberation, come to me, I'll give you. Because once you experience, definitely you are going to get liberated no matter what. This ultimate purification stage is known as omniscient state. He now enjoys the ultimate purity state. During the purification process, God as well as aspirant being passing through the various impure stages. I have lots of right now. Next summit becomes less, third summit becomes less, and so it becomes less and less and less. Purification of gold starts and then achieves complete purity. Same thing, this guy is also going to do the same thing. First time soul experiences eternal soul, eternal nature, is known as minimal state of experience. From the first samay onwards, from first samay, he experiences right now. That's a first samay. That's a minimal state. Then he goes up to 12 spiritual development state. It's called intermediary experience. And then omniscience experience is known as an ultimate and complete experience of the eternal true nature of the self. Beginning, progressive improvement of the experiencing phase, and then complete experiencing phase at the 13th gunsthana. At omniscience state, there is no more intermediate state left. He is in total engrossment in the bliss of the eternal soul state. So he has right now obtained complete purity. From the initial state of experience of the soul, the pure point, Suddhanai, becomes operational. It lasts till the soul now ends up with a complete and total experience of the eternal trueness of the omniscient state. Now, what it says, now Gurudev is bringing pure point of view. Remember, where is a pure point of view? It's a nai, right? Partial point of view. The partial point of view will only be there during the aspirant soul state. And in the aspirant soul state, there is a pure point of view. What's the function of this pure point of view in the mode? This mode right now has a pure point of view, means brought the attention to the eternal soul substance. That means a purity is generated in the mode. So pure point of view is a convention, it's a nai, it's a suddha nai, and its result is to experience eternal soul substance. It lasts, remember, pure point of view, partial point of view, nai. How long it lasts? Till one gets a omniscient knowledge. Keval gnan thai tya sudhi, pure point of view will keep on working in the mode. So now I have experiencing the soul, now I'm getting engrossed a little more, now increasing engrossment, and so that's a pure point of view helping me out. And ultimately, when I have complete experiencing the soul, that means there is no impurity present in the modes. All the mode in the omniscient Lord, they are purer and purer and purer forever. So, when the total experience of the eternal true nature of the omniscient state occurs, then there is no need for a pure point of view, because pure point of view achieved what is to be achieved. So, at omniscient state, the result of pure point of view is now achieved. So at omniscient state, the pure point of view comes to an end, naturally, because now it's an omniscient knowledge and pure point of view occurs only in the Sutta Gnan. So now we are without Sutta Gnan, we have the omniscient knowledge, and so pure point of view comes to an end. At omniscient level, pure point of view as well as conventional point of view is getting known. See, at omniscient state, what did the soul achieve? At that time, soul has a complete engrossment in the self. Complete engrossment in the self. And at the same time, there is no presence of any rag and dvesh present in the mode. Remember, what is happening in the mode right now for the Kevali Bhagwan? He is a pure mode and pure and pure and pure forever. But that purity of the mode is present in the mode, right? Experiencing of the soul is occurring completely in total in the mode, right?
Yeah.
So when it is happening in the mode, Acharya Bhagavan says, to look at the eternal soul substance is absolute point of view. To look at the modal point of view is conventional point of view. So at omniscient level, pure point of view as well as conventional point of view is getting known. Now remember, pure point of view is gone. But omniscient Lord has a knowledge of past, present, future. So he knows that this pure point of view was present before. And now in the mode, the only pure modes are present. Pure mode. The Keval Gnani Paryai. So that Paryai means it is a conventional point of view. So at omniscient level, he knows about these things. You must remember that during the...
Then you're saying that Devane still exists at 12 Gunsana? No, at the 13th Gunsana?
Because modal point of view is Vyavarnai and absolute point of view is eternal soul substance. Trikali Suddha Atma Dravya is soul substance. That's Nischaya. And on the whatever modes are occurring, Je Paryai Tha, Je Suddha Paryai. Because it's a paryay, it's a modal point of view. That's why it's conventional point of view.
Okay, so that's what I thought. But then we, a couple of slides ago, we said that for all intents and purposes, Vyavarna ends at Gunsthan 7. So yeah. What you just said now is what I thought.
Yeah.
But then we established something else. So how do those two things coexist?
Remember, the convention point of Nischayane, Vyavarna, both are relative. For example, if you want to talk about rag occurring in a person and he has now Keval Gnan Paryai, rag Paryai versus Keval Gnan Paryai. So Keval Gnan Paryai is called absolute point of view. Rag is called convention point of view. When we talk about Keval Gnan Paryai alone and we are talking in relationship to the eternal soul substance, then Keval Gnan Paryai also becomes conventional point of view. It depends which angle you are looking at it. And that's why it is an important thing for a learned student to know from which angle you're talking these sentences. For example, if I'm talking about my house, then I as a person is an absolute point of view, house becomes conventional.
So, Pirnakal, then what you were talking about previously with the absence of Vyavarna from Gunsthan 7 onwards was from the apeksha of Ashuddh Paryai. Right now you're talking about from the apeksha of any Paryai.
Shuddha Paryai, yes. Okay. So that way, we have to have the discrimination in our mind constantly. Otherwise, it's going to give, Gurudev used to give lecture and one of his cousin brother, he was a very innocent person, and I know him. I knew him when I was growing up. The guy says, Gurudev, in the morning you are telling me that rag is belonging to Pudgal, and in the evening you are telling rag is belonging to me. What do I know now? Come on, you are trying to confuse me now. The Gurudev will say, "Ah, bhai, tumne nahi samajh pade, tum bahut bola sho, you know. You are very innocent, you won't understand. Because what apeksha you are using, that is very important. What partial point of view you are using, from which angle you are using, that is very important to understand."
Yeah.
So one must remember that during aspirant state, there is presence of conviction and experience of soul as well as associated convention point of view. Why convention point of view? Because we are talking about modal point of view. We are talking aspirant. Remember the aspirant stage. Aspirant stage has a impure modes also, pure modes also, and this modes, pure modes, impure modes, so there is jumbled thing occurs. So many things are occurring in the mode, and that's why it's called conventional point of view. When there is only pure mode remaining, then it's called absolute point of view also from that particular apeksha, you know.
Okay.
Scriptural knowledge means sutagnan is a basis during the aspirant state, and the convention point of view, absolute point of view are part of the scriptural knowledge. So nai cannot be present in the omniscient Lord, nai can be into the mithyatvi. So can I know about the nai and everything? Yes, I do the study of nai and everything.
That's a different apeksha, right? So we just said from the apeksha of shuddha nai, the individual nays of a Keali Bhagwan is still Vyavarane.
Oh yeah. I mean, you know, because remember, and there is furthermore it will come that the Keali Bhagwan, knowing the whole universe, is a conventional point of view, Keali Bhagwan getting
only
in.
Only knows himself.
Yeah. So, right. So apeksha, which apeksha? That means if you want to convince somebody from certain point of view, you can.
But then, Kiran Uncle, then how can we say that nays only live in Shruta Gnan? Here you have a Kevali Bhagwan, and you just established that there's no bed in that Gnan. There's no Shruta Gnan, and Shruta Gnan is gone. Mm-hmm. And yet we still have the existence of Vyarane from the apeksha of the, you know, a bed existence of Kevali.
You are talking about knowing the universe, knowing the self, that kind of things that you are talking from the paryay of apeksha. So when you talk paryay apeksha, there is a presence of nai and everything. But in general, when you are talking keval gnan, just keval gnan alone, keval gnan doesn't know with differences and without differences. Keval gnan knows, that's it, period. So from that perspective, Keali Bhagwan has no nai. But when we talk, he is observing the whole universe, or he is getting engrossed within his own self, then we are bringing modal aspect. And remember, modal aspect will be called conventional point of view. Your point is well taken, that in a Keval Gnan, why do you want to say that there is also nai present when we say that there is no Sutta Gnan there? So when we know, and again, I don't have proper answer. I'll talk to Hemant Bhai and I'll get the answer next week. You know, I mean, it's a very good point you brought it up. Okay. Okay, all right. Omniscient Lord knows this state. He knows conventional, he knows absolute point of view, and he knows completely in toto. So that's why we just say they don't have a nai present, and from the other angle we can say still they have a nai. But I'll get you answer. I don't have right answer for you right now, but it's a very, very good question that you are raising. Okay, any questions so far? We may have to stop over here.
Well, if we're going to stop, then I wanted to ask something else about the third gatha.
Yeah.
When Hemant Bhai was here,
okay,
he pointed to a line, and I didn't have the heart to stop him and ask a lot of questions. Mm-hmm. He pointed to some line in the Tika, Amritchandacharya Dev's Tika, on the Ekatva Nischay Gatha of Samay Sarji. Mm-hmm. And he pointed to a line in that Tika, and he said that this line is where Amritchandacharya Dev says that the Paryayas of one Dravya and the Paryayas of a second Dravya have absolutely no connection and no causal relationship.
He talked about four types of abhav: prag bhav, pradvansa bhav, anyanya bhav, and atyanta bhav. That's what he talked about, if I'm not mistaken. That means in me right now, my present mode has no relationship with the past mode. That's a prag bhav. Prag abhav. Prag means past, and abhav means absence of it. Pradvansa bhav means pradvansa means future. So future is also not present in the present mode. So this present mode is independent of its own. It doesn't.
No, that's not what I'm asking you. Okay. He pointed to a line in that tika of the third gatha, where he said that, you know how everybody loves to say that one dravya doesn't do anything to a different dravya?
Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm. You know, everybody loves to keep saying that. But he actually pointed to the sentence in the Tika where Amut Chandacharya said essentially that. Now, what I wanted to know if, I don't know if you have it handy.
No, I had a book. Have that,
huh?
I had a book in front of me. I opened that book.
Can you find that, please? And can you just slowly read it to me and then maybe a couple of minutes explain that? I don't know what he was talking about, but I did ask him, Hemant Bhai, is this the sentence where Amrut Chandacharya says that? He says, yes, this is the sentence. It's in the third, in the Tika of the third gatha. In Atma Kyati.
See, what he tried to say, and if I'm not, I mean, I understand correctly, that he said that, see, ekatva nishchay gata samaye sarvatra sunga lokma, tethi bane vikvadini bandhan katha ekatva.
But that's the gatha. I'm talking about the
tika. For time infinite, I have taken my ownership in the alien objects of the universe. And alien object means body, basically, you know. The body is mine, body is mine, body is mine. I can do body's function. I can enjoy body. I can do the action of body. All kind of. Ekatva, mamatva, kartutva, bhoktutva, yeah. So that is sarvatra sundar ekatva nirgas. Tethi bane vikvadini means this kind of thing I have done since time infinite to have the ownership in the alien objects of the universe. And that's why it is extremely common for me. And at that time, I have forgotten that if I have the ekatva nishchay, if I just believe in my own self, if I believe in my own self, then it is a beautiful thing. Which
I'm talking about the tika.
Yeah, yeah. So to open jo paraspar ekbijana sparsh karta nathi je shu kahu potana dravyama antarmarda rayal potana anant dharmo ne chakra ne samuh ne chumbe che sparshe che to pan jeo paraspar ekbijana sparsh karta nathi atyant nikat ek satra vaga pran raya che to pan jeo sadakal potana swarup thi padta nathi par rupe nahi pranaman lide anant vyaktitana nash pamti nathi. Itle, what it says over here, even I'm with the body in the same space point since time infinite, but I remain as me and body remains as body because body is mode and my mode, they have atyanta abhav, means there is no relationship with these two modes at all. Yes, that I have a problem with my eyes and I come to you and you just do the operation for me and I can see better. But that is a body's function. This eyes function. What happened to the soul? Nothing happened to the soul. So soul remains as it is, even though it appears that there is a relationship with the alien object, but that is nimit nemitik sambandh only. So my eyes became blurry and you happened to be there and you helped me out. You were supposed to do that work and my eyes were supposed to become bad. And we just both were present at the same time. And so, Ankit took care of it and that's why I'm okay. Yes, Nimit is present and we have to respect Nimit, but at the same time, we have to understand that the Nimit doesn't do anything. Yes, in a conventional state, we will talk about it. Okay, Ankit was good and that's why he helped me out, but he has not done anything to me. So that kind of thing, that the soul's mode and the body's mode, they are absolutely free from each other, no relationship to each other, except for Nimit, Nimitik Samad.
Oh, that's wonderful. Kiranko, can you, thank you for reading that and explaining that. Can you, maybe with your phone, can you take a photograph of that page and maybe underline that sentence that you just read and maybe text it or email it to me, please?
No problem.
I'd like to review it a little more closely.
Yeah, yeah, okay. All right. Thanks, Ankit. Thank you, Bita.
Thank you.
Okay. Javani ke gyan se suje lo ka lo sovani mastakan mo sada deta ho do. 9 times of a count. Jai Jinendra.
Jai Jinendra.
Thanks.